Okay, good evening, everyone. Bonsoir. We're going to start in a few minutes. There's still people coming up, so we're going to wait a couple of minutes. On va attendre juste quelques minutes parce qu'il y a encore des gens qui viennent. Alors, j'aimerais faire quelques petites annonces. Il y a deux sorties, entrée de la salle, l'entrée principale, et il y a une autre entrée-sortie ici à votre gauche. So, there are two main entry exit points from the room, the main entrance that you came in, and then another exit entrance on your left. Si vous cherchez les salles de bain, les toilettes, veuillez sortir par l'entrée principale puis virer à droite. If you're looking for the washrooms, you can go out the main entranceway and turn right and you'll find the bathrooms just down the hall. Alors, on va commencer dans trois ou quatre, entre trois et cinq minutes. Merci. We're going to start in 3 to 5 minutes. Thanks.
Thank you.
All right. Good evening, everybody. Bonsoir tout le monde. Thank you all for coming out to this, our final event of the 2018-2019 Urbanism Lab season. Donc, merci de participer à notre dernier événement de cette année. We're thrilled to have three great speakers and a fourth commentator who's going to come up afterwards as well. And so to get us started, I'd like to call up our CEO, Mr. Toby Nussbaum. Donc, j'aimerais inviter Monsieur Toby Nussbaum, notre premier dirigeant.
Merci, Stan. Bonjour, good evening, Kwaka Kina. I would like to start this evening by acknowledging that we are here on the traditional territory of the Algonquin Nation. And I want to welcome everyone to the Urbanism Lab, everyone who's here with us physically, and to those of you on the live stream, which I think is looking at me right through there. Good evening and welcome. Pour ceux et celles d'entre vous qui viennent ici pour la première fois, je suis heureux que vous vous soyez joints à nous. Pour ceux et celles qui sont des habitués, merci de votre appui. Because especially, as Stan said, because it is the last session of a very successful another season of the Urbanism Lab. And has become a tradition here at the NCC. We're ending the season to coincide with the summer solstice and National Indigenous Peoples Day. When as a country, we reflect on the history, on the traditions, the culture, and the contributions to Canada of the First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples. Au cours des dernières années, le Labo a organisé des présentations et des discussions remarquables sur l'édification de communautés autochtones, prospère à la création d'espaces autochtones dans la capitale. Nous avons entendu des panels d'architectes, d'autochtones et d'autres autochtones aussi. and important because this region has a long association with Indigenous peoples. We know it was a center for cultural and trading exchange many thousands of years ago, attracting traders and travelers from all over Eastern North America. And tonight's subject, for that reason, is of great importance, and especially just a month or so after the floods that we experienced on the heels of course, flooding that we had in 2017 as well. De telles inondations présentent un risque pour les archives archéologiques de la région et en tant qu'intendant principal du patrimoine culturel de la capitale, il est de responsabilité de la CCN d'atténuer et de minimiser les risques et les dommages. So last summer, in light of that, the NCC enlisted the Patterson Group as part of its assessment and rescue of archaeological legacy project, a multi-year investigation into the erosion of shorelines managed by the NCC. The 2018 assessment focused on the Quebec side of the Ottawa River, and the research confirmed that fluctuating water levels, and in particular the floods of 2017, as I mentioned, have led to increasingly serious damage to 16 archaeological sites, two of which had been previously unrecorded. Tonight, we're going to take a look at what we're doing and what more we should be doing to protect and preserve archaeological treasures in the face of unpredictable and dangerous climate events. At this point, I would like to acknowledge Ian Badgley. Ian, where are you? Right there. And Ian is our in-house archaeologist. He has been instrumental in putting this program together this evening. And just as he has championed this session in the lab, he has long been a champion for archaeology in the capital and dedicated himself to preserving its history and extending our knowledge about it. Thank you very much, Ian, for everything you've done. So let me quickly introduce our panel. So I'll start with Matthew Betts, who is the curator of Eastern Archaeology at the Canadian Museum of History. He is also director of the Coastal Archaeology Project, which in collaboration with the Acadia First Nation is seeking to address the effects of erosion on the archaeological sites of Nova Scotia's South Shore. Nadine Kopp is an archaeologist with the Patterson Group and was the principal investigator of the assessment I just spoke of, which she will address and speak about this evening. Marie-Lou Leclerc, qui est archéologue au sein à la CEPEC, travaille au Parc national de la Témiscouata sur le territoire des Malécites et collabore étroitement avec les membres de la Première Nation Malécite de la région. And Christina Ruddy is manager of the Algonquin Way Cultural Center in Pickwaukonigan. She has spent her career working to empower Indigenous young people to celebrate their identity, their language, and culture. She also works with educators at all levels to make schools more inclusive and aware of Indigenous context and ways of teaching. So thank you all for being here. Merci, miigwech, and I look very much forward to hearing the panel. Thank you, Stan.
I'm just going to have my phone going so I don't go over time. I've been known to do that. I'd also like to acknowledge that we're on the traditional homeland of the Algonquin Nation, and that's a true honor to be able to live and work in this beautiful ancestral land. Today I'm going to talk about the greatest threat to tangible heritage that exists in the world today, and probably that has ever existed. By tangible heritage, I mean built heritage and archaeological heritage, the material legacy that humans leave behind. In the next 80 years, climate scientists have indicated that sea levels will rise between 25 centimeters and 200 centimeters. That's in the next 80 years. At the same time, climate events are becoming more severe, periodicity of storm events are increasing, and we experience things like we just experienced with the national capital flood that we just had. And of course, this leads to the destruction of tangible built heritage. This destruction is more intense than anything that could be caused by war, anything that could be caused by human development. and it ends in things like this. This is a Maui statue that was eroded from a near shore site. It was undercut by the ocean waves and toppled, and then continues to erode. The indigenous people of the area, it's a sacred Maui statue. They've tried their best to commemorate it, but it's going to be lost. We have things like the Suandro Neolithic site in Orkney, very large site. This barrow was unknown. Several years ago, it was exposed during one storm, just one storm. You can see that the local people have built a retaining wall trying to protect it, but that hasn't worked, and the site continues to be dismantled by the waves and will probably be lost within the next several years. So are just two snapshots from across the globe. Where does Canada sit with this? Well, the government of Canada just released a remarkable report on climate change. And in that report, it outlines what we can expect within the next 80 years by the turn of the century. In Nova Scotia and the Maritime Provinces, between 75 and 100 centimeters of sea level increase. In BC, it's 50 centimeters. In the north, it can go anywhere from 25 to 125 centimeters. And that, of course, comes with it the loss of permafrost, the loss of glaciers, and increased storm events that can destroy sites. Canada has the longest coastline in the world. It also has the largest freshwater system in the world. Our coastline is 100% longer than the next highest country with a large coastline. That means we sit at the apex of this cultural heritage crisis. And so this is just a snapshot of some sites we know of that are being impacted in Canada. On the upper left, that's Herschel Island in the Yukon. That's a Euro-Canadian whaling station being inundated by a storm surge. Under the storm surge is an 800-year-old Inuit site that's being actively dismantled. On the right is a Euro-Canadian kiln in near Bredor Lake in Cape Breton. That's about to fall into the sea, but the Mi'kmaq site that it was sitting on is completely destroyed. On the lower left is a buffalo jump site in Manitoba. Thousands of years of hunting has left a bed of bones, bison bones. Shows the record of indigenous occupation and hunting and relationship with the land there. And it's being washed away every spring with the flood. For indigenous peoples, this is a former justice minister with the chief of Acadia First Nation. For indigenous peoples, this is a real, true crisis. It's not just an archaeological crisis or a history crisis. It's a social and cultural and economic crisis. In Canada, the Supreme Court of Canada and Superior Court obligates indigenous people to show recurring and long-term use of lands and resources to establish rights in treaty-based negotiations and in other negotiations. Doing that thus requires archaeological data, the material evidence of people's use of the landscape from time immemorial. How are indigenous people supposed to be able to do that when it's being washed away with every storm or with every flood? It's very difficult. And so this is a social issue, a cultural issue, and a heritage issue for indigenous peoples, and an economic issue. The Truth and Reconciliation Report and the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People outline how indigenous people are supposed to rally their history in support of their social and cultural movements. Reconciliation, therefore, obligates us to try to help them to preserve their heritage so that they can rally it to those social and cultural and economic movements. I work in Nova Scotia. This is a site that's not impacted by erosion. It's called a shell midden. It's about a meter deep. It's all shells with lots of animal bones and artifacts. They're wonderful things. They don't look like much. They look like a lot of shells, but they neutralize the acidic soils in Nova Scotia, and they preserve artifacts and animal bones in pristine condition, and you get a pristine record of what ancient Mi'kmaq were doing on the coast when they occupied these sites. They're absolutely wonderful things. And here's an assistant of mine, Andrea, excavating. We excavate meticulously, layer by layer, measuring everything as we go. The relationships between the objects are very, very important. So you can see we have a lot of measuring gear. We take a lot of notes. This is the ideal for archaeology. For 10 years, I worked with Acadia First Nation to explore their history in a place where there wasn't erosion going on. I kind of had blinders on and earmuffs on. I knew there was erosion. All archaeologists are aware of this. But we worked in a place where we didn't have to deal with it. When this project wound down and we're just about to publish the monograph on it, we knew that if we want to continue working to find out what was going on before about 2,000 years ago, we'd have to start dealing with erosion. We'd have to start moving to other places where we could find sites that were a little bit older. And when we decided to do that with Acadia First Nation, we decided we had to have a new type of archaeology. And that was one, because we would be going on the coast looking for sites that were eroding and making decisions about which sites to put our resources towards, that couldn't be a decision that I had to make about what sites to excavate. It had to be a decision that Acadia First Nation had to make and the Mi'kmaq had to make about which sites to preserve, because it's their history that's being washed away with every storm. So we developed a new project called Coastal. It's a long acronym. You can ask me about it afterwards. But it's what we call it, a collaborative management project. We have equal numbers of archaeologists and Indigenous peoples on a management committee from Acadia First Nation and the Mi'kmaq Rights Initiative. We come together to decide how to use our resources to best preserve sites, both from an archaeological standpoint, but also, more importantly, from an Indigenous standpoint. What sites do they need to preserve for their own social and historical movements? And so with this sort of management structure in place, we moved towards doing some work in 2017 on the coast. Built into the DNA of the project is capacity building or training. This is Sarah. She's an AFN member. She's working, she's learning here how to map a site. We also do a lot of community engagement. It's time consuming, but takes a lot of effort. But you have to engage with the community. These are the people that know where the sites are. These are the people whose properties you're traipsing over to find sites. And these are the people you have to engage with to do proper archaeology. So we do tours and site visits for both Acadia First Nation members and local community members. So how did the project work? Well, this is the you can see the South Shore of Nova Scotia. Unfortunately, the pointer doesn't work very well. You can see where the South Shore of Nova Scotia, where we work. All of the dots that you see on this map are sites that have been discovered by archaeologists or other individuals prior to about 1990. So there's approximately 50 of them. We know there's probably at least twice as many sites that exist on that coastline, probably many more, but these are the sites that have been found by archaeologists. Our goal for the 2017 season, it was only a few weeks, was to audit those sites, as many as we could, to see if they're still there, if they're being impacted by coastal erosion. If they're not being impacted by coastal erosion, what's the state of them? Because nobody's really gone back to look in about 40 years. The other objective was to survey coastlines where we could to find new sites. And so we did that. We went, there was about five of us. We drove around. We got to see the most beautiful coastline in the world for about 2 weeks. But what we found was pretty gut-wrenching. We found site after site eroding or destroyed. This is a shell midden site. So imagine the picture of the shell midden I showed you being excavated. This was once that, but now it's being dismantled by the ocean. You can see where this tree's overturned and the shell's spilling out. All of the artifacts that were associated in the shells, all their associations with each other are lost or gone, and reduces the information that we can learn from the site. But actually, for us, that's a good news story. There's at least something left. Other sites were completely destroyed. This was described as a large shell midden site, about 50 centimeters deep in the 1970s, with artifacts sort of spilling out of it, which extended back for at least a few meters. When we arrived in 2017, we could find no evidence that people had even been there. So talk about rallying archaeology towards established long-term and enduring use of landscapes. There's no evidence that the Mi'kmaq were there now. It's gone. We could find no flakes. We could find no artifacts. There's just no evidence that there was an archaeological deposit there. Many sites we found were like this. This was also described as a shell midden in 1974 with several centimeters of overburden on top of it with artifacts spilling out and animal bones. When we arrived in 2017, all we could find were several bits of flakes. But that's the chips that come off of making stone tools, lying amongst the rocks in the intertidal. No animal bones, no real formal artifacts. It's just as if somebody sort of scooped it up and pushed it into the ocean and we couldn't find it. So effectively destroyed. There's a little bit of information. At least we know that there were people there, but we don't know what they were doing other than making stone tools. This is another site that we found, a little bit of a shelmidden eroding on a small island in Sable River. I just found out, yes, literally just yesterday, I'm not making this up, somebody sent a photograph of the place, and there's no evidence of shell anymore. The storm last year in Sable River destroyed the site. It's, it seems like it's gone. We'll test it when we go back, but it looks like it's gone. So what did we achieve in 2 weeks? Well, we looked at 21 sites that we looked at to audit, to see if they're still there, to get some information on them. And we also discovered a few more sites, not many. We looked at about 20 kilometers of coastline that we surveyed. It doesn't seem like much, but when you're walking over it on foot, it's quite a bit. We found a couple of sites. Unfortunately, 92.6% of the sites that were known prior to 1990, 92.6 of them are destroyed. That means there's no stratigraphy left, there's very little artifacts. Really, all of the archaeological information is missing from those sites. They're just gone. And if you think about what that means in terms of archaeology and history, it means it's roughly a 2,000 years of history lost since 1950, and I'll tell you why. The sites we were excavating in the protected harbor go back to about 2,000 years. We knew if we wanted to find earlier evidence, we'd have to go to these high-risk eroding coastlines. In the 1950s, 60s, and 70s, people discovered and recorded some of those dots that you saw on the map were sites that were dated to 4,000 years old, 3,600, 4,000, something like that. We couldn't find any of those. They're all gone. So that 2,000 years of history is completely gone in 50 years. That's what we're dealing with on the South Shore of Nova Scotia. So quite alarming. We didn't expect this. The Nova Scotia Museum didn't expect it. We had a hint that it would be bad. We didn't know it would be that bad. So where do we go from there? This is quite alarming to us. I came back to the museum and started talking with people who can make decisions. And luckily, my director and the director general of the museum recognized, and my manager as well, recognized that this was an important issue. That the museum had a bit of a mandate to explore. And so we decided to host a symposium at the Canadian Archaeological Association Conference in Winnipeg in 2018. We wanted to get an idea of how bad the situation is in the rest of the country. And it's not like archaeologists haven't known about this, but we wanted to know what other people were experiencing. Was it as bad as in Nova Scotia? And what people were doing about it. We wanted to get some information. And so we held a symposium. We invited about 30 archaeologists and Indigenous experts, academics, provincial and territorial archaeologists, and Indigenous experts to come and tell us what they know. And it's bad. On the upper left is an Inuvialuit house, about 500 years old, eroding into the ocean. These are all photographs from that symposium. On the lower right is a Dorset site, about 2,500 years old, an important one because yarn was found there. A very unique sort of yarn was found there. That's eroding into the ocean. Very important site. On the right here is a site called the Beaches in Newfoundland. Probably has the very long and uninterrupted sequence of archaeological and Indigenous history in Newfoundland, one of the best preserved sites, completely eroding away. You can see that the community members actually think the site's so important they tried to build a berm to protect it, but you can see that's been transgressed and the site's being dismantled. On the left is a site in PEI that's been an Indigenous site that's been completely destroyed, no evidence left. So it's bad everywhere, really bad. So what are the results? Every coastline in Canada is affected, all of the major water systems as well. East Coast is particularly badly affected, but the north, the Arctic is really, really badly affected, and BC as well, everywhere, essentially. The available data indicates massive destruction on a scale that's really difficult to wrap your mind around. Some people have called this the burning library syndrome, talking about the Library of Alexandria. Although I don't think that's an apt analogy, it's more like thousands of burning libraries all over the country, and we don't have a hose to put on them. Notre Dame Cathedral, it's hundreds of Notre Dame cathedrals, and we don't have a hose. So The big thing we learned from the symposium, the scope of the impact is partly unknown. Vast portions of our coastlines and river systems and lake systems have not been surveyed, so we don't know what archaeology exists. We don't know what archaeology is endangered. There's a lot of Canadian history that we don't know. Everywhere archaeologists are racing against time, but the big thing is that they have few resources. Some people have been lucky. The NCC has really stepped up. Parks Canada is doing a great job with what they have. But mostly everywhere else, the provinces, territories, there's a few limited resources. The other big thing is that the public's almost completely unaware of the crisis, almost completely unaware. People are aware when bridges wash out or when their front yards go into the sea, but they're not aware of the heritage crisis. We haven't been doing a very good job about broadcasting that to the public. The big thing that came away from the symposium is that action is needed immediately. Every day we wait, another site gets destroyed. Every year we wait, thousands of sites, hundreds of sites are impacted. So the next day, we decided, well, it can't just all be doom and gloom. Let's see if there's something we can do about this. And so we held a workshop with the same group of specialists from all across the country. Here they are, all smiling in the face of devastation. And we decided that we were going to ask them, in a perfect world, with a perfect situation, how can we address this? How can we come together to address this? And it was remarkable. We had 30 experts, 30 archaeologists, indigenous experts and others. Usually you get those people in the room, they don't agree on anything, but they all agreed on this scenario. It was remarkable. The first thing they suggested what we need is a call to action. This is something to raise people's blood levels and to talk about the crisis, but also talk about how we need to act. And I'll read it to you. Canada is in the grip of an unmitigated heritage catastrophe. Erosion and climate change are destroying archaeological sites on a devastating scale and at an alarming rate. Thousands of years of archaeological and indigenous history have already been lost, and there is no coordinated program to address the issue. The future of the past is at extreme risk, and we must act now. And you'll see for the next portion of the talk, I'll just show slides of devastation at the bottom just to reinforce how bad things are all over. And I thank the people at the symposium who gave me information on this. The other thing we asked the workshop, were you aware of any current programs, provincial, municipal, federal programs that could help us address this issue? And the experts said that there's no comprehensive programs that they could identify. There's no national overarching program that anybody can go to get funds to address this issue. There's no federal funder agency responsible. The provinces and territories have very limited funds. The SHRC and NSERC, as great as institutions as they are, they're not set up to fund exploratory or salvage projects. They fund research projects based on hypothesis testing. Parks Canada, NCC grapple with erosion, as we know, and they've had some success for sure, but we know that they struggle as well. Our workshop suggested that they do as well. They suggested that national leadership is needed on the funding level. So what's a vision for a national response? What did they sort of agree on? Well, they suggested we need a program, and a program that could be managed by an institution with a mandate and experience, a national mandate and experience. There's only a couple. CMH is one of them, the Canadian Museum of History. That the program should be directed by an arm's length steering committee that's composed of a large proportion of indigenous and community partners, probably a co-managed steering committee. Most of the sites that would be salvaged in a program like this are indigenous. There'd be a large proportion of Euro-Canadian sites as well, of course, but indigenous co-management would need to be baked into the DNA of any project program. They suggested that potentially a funding program is needed. With a competitive proposal submission. So one solution doesn't fit all. A funding program deals with that. People can apply with their own solutions to get funds to do the work that's necessary in their regions. And they suggested 55 funded projects at a minimum would be necessary, and there's a reason for that number. I'll tell you about it in a minute. And so essentially what they suggested we need is a national erosion archaeology program or a national rescue archaeology program. What would be the objectives of the program? Well, as we said, 55 funded projects. And by funded projects, we don't mean sites. We mean projects. So we're talking hundreds of sites. A 5-year duration, And the reason for this is that we need to be able to assess after people are out in the field and boots are on the ground, assess how bad the damage is, and then reassess. We understand that the program may not has to evolve with what we're finding. One of the objectives, a big objective, would be develop partnerships. This crisis is too large for any one institution to take on alone. It's going to need partnerships. And I should be clear that these are the partnerships that the workshop suggested might be necessary. CERNAC, ISC, of course, Canadian Heritage, Environment Canada, Parks Canada, SHRC, they all have resources that could be rallied and could be potential people to reach out to. And they could provide funding or logistical support. Now, I mentioned 55 projects. Is there hope that something like this could be mounted? Well, we do know it's possible because the Canadian Museum of History used to do it. Between 1972 and 1994, the museum with its partners, some of whom were on the previous slide, Indian Northern Affairs at the time, Parks Canada, Public Works, well, they're all part of it. And all provided funds and logistical support. Between 1972 and 1994, the museum funded 143 projects. But the important thing is the first 3 years of the graph, when there was about 60 projects. That's the bulk of the work that was done in the rescue program, except for at the very end, which was in a specific area. And if you look at this, the reason I have a really exciting picture of a library of a bookcase here, of a bookcase here, is that this is the Canadian Museum of History's Mercury Series. It's a compilation of archaeological reports on the prehistory, the Indigenous history of Canada. There's currently 180 reports in it. It's still ongoing. The first about 120, all of the orange volumes were written from projects that took place in the first 3 to 4 years of this project. So we know that a limited amount of work can result in a massive amount of data. And really, this is where the archaeological history of Canada was written down for the first time, that spurred a whole archaeological industry. And so that we know that a small 5-year duration, 55 project program would result in a lot of information saved and preserved about Canadian archaeology. So where do we move forward from here? So I want to leave on a high note, not on a low note, although I will. This is another site that's destroyed in Nova Scotia, so it's not all perfect. But we do have a way forward. I attended a meeting with the Canadian Museum of History's CEO recently to discuss this issue, and we're going to explore a way to move forward. He empowered our division, the research division, to identify members of an advisory panel. We have to start from the ground up. With an advisory panel which involves a large proportion of Indigenous experts, so we did develop the right approach. We're going to determine possible partners and contributors. We're doing that as we speak. And we're going to move forward with a phase one proposal, a pilot project. We don't know what that's going to be right now. We don't know how it's going to look, but we do know that we have a possibility to move forward and address the issue, and it's a start. It's a wonderful start. And it was a remarkable meeting. So what can you guys do to help? I suspect many people here work for the government. Most people in Ottawa do. And if you don't, get the word out. Spread the word that this isn't a crisis. Spread the word to the people in your departments. And if you work in a department that could potentially partner to do something on this, reach out. Here's my email. I have cards. And we'd love to hear from you. And we'd love to hear from you in your comments after this talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Matthew. It's now my honor to call upon Marianne Marie-Lou Leclerc. Donc, je vous invite au podium.
Pas de problème, je vais prendre le temps de remercier Mathieu pour sa superbe introduction sur le sujet. Vous voyez que c'est un sujet de site qui va être en danger, donc alarmant. Euh, Je me présente, mon nom c'est Marianne Marleau-Leclerc, comme on me présentait un peu au début. Je travaille principalement au Parc national du lac Témiscouata, qui est dans le Bas-Saint-Laurent. Peut-être que pas beaucoup de monde connaissent le Témiscouata, mais vous allez voir sur la carte, je vais vous présenter tantôt. C'est une région un peu mal connue. Je vais m'introduire un peu avec aussi ma présentation. Wolastoqawik, en fait, territoire ancestral, c'est les Malécites, se nomment eux autres les Wolastoqawik. Donc, Wolastoqawik, c'est leur territoire ancestral, qui est un élément fondamental, bien sûr, de leur définition, leur territoire, et qui est, bien sûr, tragiquement menacé par l'érosion. Et je vous la présente aussi parce que c'est pas une nation qui est très connue. Donc, puis juste pour bien introduire. Donc, la première nation malécite de Vigée, qui a été aussi appelée les Etchemins, les Amalécites, les Malécites, qui est un terme, en fait, Mi'kmaq, qui veut dire les gens qui ont un drôle de parler. En fait, les Européens qui ont rencontré les Autochtones en premier, les Mi'kmaq, bien, les Mi'kmaq, on dit, le groupe à côté, c'est les Malécites. Donc, qui parlent drôlement. Donc, c'est resté. Et les Malécites préfèrent, bien sûr, ne pas se faire appeler comme ça. Donc, tranquillement, le nom va changer. Wolastoqawik est le nom de leur nation qui veut dire les gens de la belle rivière. Donc, c'est un peu plus joli. Puis, vous allez comprendre aussi pourquoi ils s'appellent comme ça. C'est sûr que leur territoire longe des rivières. Et aujourd'hui, ils vont vraiment changer de nom officiellement pour Wolastoqawik. Il y a deux réserves malécites au Québec, donc Whitworth, qui a été fondée en 1875, et Kakuna en 1891. Leur première réserve, qui est assez intéressante, qu'ils ont aujourd'hui perdue, c'est en 1826 qu'elle a été fondée, et c'était une des premières réserves autochtones du Québec. Donc, c'est quand même intéressant de savoir ça. Par contre, ils n'ont été qu'officiellement reconnus en 1989, et étant comme la 11e nation du Québec. Donc, ça a été quand même tardif. C'est aussi la raison pourquoi on les connaît souvent moins, les Malécites, parce qu'ils ont été reconnus très tardivement. Et aujourd'hui, ils comptent 1202 personnes. Ça, c'est pour la partie Québec, parce que vous allez voir tantôt, je vais montrer, mais leur territoire est aussi au Nouveau-Brunswick puis au Maine. Donc, la plus grande partie de la population se trouve au Nouveau-Brunswick puis au Maine et peu au Québec. Donc, voici leur territoire ancestral. On voit vraiment bien, comme j'ai dit, la grande partie, c'est la partie en foncé, donc qui traverse le Québec, le Maine, le Nouveau-Brunswick, mais la majorité de leur territoire et de leur réserve est aujourd'hui plus au Nouveau-Brunswick. Et je fais remarquer tout de suite, tantôt on va le voir, mais vraiment à l'intérieur de leur territoire coule une grande rivière qui est la rivière Saint-Jean. Ça part vraiment, il y a une trajectoire qui peut partir du fleuve Saint-Laurent jusqu'à la baie de Fundy. Et c'était une rivière facilement navigable qui a été empruntée. Puis on voit vraiment que leur territoire longe ce couloir-là. De là, leur nom, les gens de la belle rivière. C'est vraiment parce que leur territoire longeait ce couloir navigable. Et le parc national d'où je travaille se situe juste ici, donc vraiment au centre de leur territoire, la partie Québec, les longes de lac Témiscouata. Donc, c'est le lac Témiscouata, le deuxième plus long lac au sud du Québec. Se trouve exactement en plein milieu. On voit la réserve de Vigée, pas celle de Kakuna, mais est pas très, très, pas, celle de Whitworth n'est pas très, très loin. Et le parc s'est vraiment doté depuis son ouverture. En fait, le parc national de lac Témiscouata est ouvert. C'est un récent parc, c'est en 2013 qu'il est ouvert. Donc, dès le début, il s'est vraiment doté d'une couleur plus archéologique. Il y a d'autres parcs comme Mégantic, c'est vraiment sur les étoiles, Miguacha, la paléontologie. Nous, c'est vraiment notre couleur de parc est vraiment l'archéologie parce qu'il y a vraiment beaucoup de sites archéologiques sur le territoire. On est rendu à 54 sites archéologiques. Donc, autant qu'on va parler de cette archéologie-là, qu'on va parler aussi beaucoup de la Première Nation. Donc, c'est vraiment nos thématiques principales, l'archéologie et la nation autochtone de la place qui vont être mises en valeur dans le parc. On remarque tout de suite avec la carte où sont situés la plupart des sites, bien sûr, le long des berges. C'est la majorité de nos sites archéologiques sont des sites autochtones de l'histoire amérindienne avant l'arrivée des Européens. On a quelques sites, sept, qui compte plutôt une histoire récente des camps forestiers. Donc, on a aussi une histoire récente, mais la majorité des 54, c'est l'histoire autochtone. Il y en a un qui date de l'époque paléo-indienne, pour ceux qui savent c'est quoi, c'est l'époque la plus ancienne. Donc, on parle de... Ce site-là est de 10 000 ans, mais en fait, paléo-indien, c'est 12 à 10 000 ans. Donc, on a quand même une vieille histoire autochtone dans le parc. Une autre 5 sites archéologiques datent de la période archaïque et le reste, c'est sylvicole. Donc, c'est plutôt l'époque plus récente. Et pourquoi qu'on a autant de sites archéologiques dans le parc? Une raison principale, c'est qu'on a une carrière de la pierre qui était idéale pour faire des outils à l'intérieur du parc. C'est qui s'appelle le chert. C'est le chert touladi, la pierre. C'est l'équivalent, en fait, du silex. En Europe, on a le silex. En Amérique, une des pierres qui était le plus utilisée pour faire des outils par les Amérindiens, c'était le chert. Donc, on a une carrière de cette pierre-là, qui est un élément vraiment fondamental dans la vie des Autochtones, parce que pour se faire des outils et donc pour faire toutes les autres activités, la pêche, la chasse, on a besoin d'outils en pierre. Donc, à la base, il fallait savoir où trouver les bonnes pierres pour se faire des outils. Et on en a la chance d'avoir ça dans notre parc. Donc, ça a attiré des Autochtones de partout, parce que les carrières se trouvent un peu réparties sur le territoire. Des fois, on parle de 300 à 500 kilomètres avant d'atteindre une autre carrière. Donc, vraiment, ça rassemblait tous les gens dans un grand secteur autour d'une source. C'est souvent même ça qui a créé des villages, des lieux de rassemblement aussi. Et cette carrière-là a été utilisée depuis 10 000 ans. On a vraiment des traces du premier site le plus vieux qu'on a. Déjà, ils connaissaient la carrière de pierre. Une autre des raisons qu'on a beaucoup de sites archéologiques, c'est sûr, c'est la voie navigable. On a la chance que cette carrière-là se trouvait à côté de la voie navigable. C'est sûr que quand on parle de l'époque autochtone, on oublie des fois, nous, qu'à l'époque, il n'y avait pas de chemin, pas de route. Donc, les routes devenaient les cours d'eau. Donc, il fallait que ce soit accessible. Et ça se trouve directement sur la voie navigable. Donc, à un moment, on pouvait partir du fleuve Saint-Laurent, descendre jusqu'à la baie de Fundy, par ici, en passant par le lac Témiscouata. Donc, toute cette région-là pouvait être distribuée de cette ressource de chert. Depuis la fondation du parc en 2009, il s'est vraiment doté d'un programme avec un partenariat avec la Première Nation de la région. On était sur leur territoire ancestral. Donc, on a vraiment monté plusieurs projets de collaboration depuis, entre autres des consultations auprès pour quel site qu'on allait fouiller à chaque année. On a une de nos activités principales au parc, c'est qu'on fait de la fouille publique. Donc, j'amène chaque été avec moi des gens, des visiteurs venir fouiller vraiment un vrai site qu'on a choisi. Et ça, on le fait avec la Première Nation, quel site qui les intéresse qu'on fouille. On fait de la conservation, bien sûr. Le parc est un lieu de conservation, autant pour le milieu naturel, mais que culturel aussi. Donc, on fait de la préservation et de la mise en valeur, bien sûr, de leur culture aussi au parc. On a d'autres activités autres que l'archéologie qui parlent de la Première Nation. Les projets de recherche aussi qu'on a sur les anciens niveaux marins. Donc, ce qu'on veut, c'est aussi trouver des sites plus anciens. Et bien sûr, on fait des recherches sur la carrière de pierre, carrière de chert. On a monté aussi des vitrines muséales avec quelques artefacts pour montrer qu'est-ce qu'on trouvait. Et on parle peut-être d'un assistant archéologue autochtone éventuellement. Et finalement, notre projet principal en ce moment, c'est la protection des sites en danger. On a commencé avec ce projet d'érosion-là, c'est tout de suite après l'ouverture du parc en 2013, 2014, l'année suivante, on a refait le tour de tous les sites archéologiques. Parce qu'il faut comprendre que beaucoup avaient été trouvés bien avant l'ouverture du parc. On parle des années 60 pour certains sites. Ça fait vraiment longtemps qu'il y a des recherches archéologiques dans le Témiscouata. Quand le parc a ouvert, ça faisait longtemps que ces sites-là n'avaient pas été visités. Donc, on voulait savoir dans quel état ils étaient tous rendus. C'est sûr que les récents, on avait une idée, mais les plus anciens, on n'était pas trop au courant de dans quel état ils étaient rendus. Donc, on a fait le tour de tous les 54 sites qu'on avait. Et on s'est rendu compte rapidement que 11 de ces sites-là étaient vraiment en dégradation par l'érosion principalement. D'autres facteurs aussi un peu à cause des visiteurs, mais principalement à cause de l'érosion. Donc, on s'est dit qu'il faut faire quelque chose. Et en 2016, la Nation Malécite est venue visiter. On les a amenés en canot visiter les sites archéologiques. Et bien sûr, ben, comme on est parti en canot, les sites qu'on a visités, c'est ceux le long des berges. Et rapidement, ils se sont rendus compte eux-mêmes aussi qu'il y avait plusieurs sites que l'érosion grugeait. Donc, ça a été leur premier réflexe, un peu comme Mathieu disait, parce que c'est pour eux important leur patrimoine, non seulement pour se reconnaître leur culture, mais aussi, c'est comme une preuve qu'ils ont été là, d'avoir un site. C'est que tu sais qu'ils ont passé là. Si tu perds l'information, tu perds aussi le fait de dire qu'ils étaient là avant. Donc, c'est vraiment, ça a été vraiment pour eux super important de dire il faut qu'on fasse quelque chose et on protège ces sites archéologiques. Donc, on a vraiment commencé à monter un projet. Il y a 3 sites qui ont été ciblés à ce moment-là, qui semblaient être plus en danger que d'autres. Donc, c'est avec la nation qui ont vraiment choisi ces 3 sites à prioriser dans les travaux. Le premier, c'est le CKEE-12. On remarque un peu déjà des photos de la berge qui s'érode. Donc, c'est vraiment le sable qui amène les artefacts sur la plage. Puis après ça, l'année suivante, la plage, le niveau d'eau au printemps, vraiment reprendre tous les artefacts et les faire disparaître. On voyait pas bien sur la carte, fait que j'ai vraiment fait des petits trapeaux. Donc, ici, 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 ici. C'est des concentrations d'artefacts qu'on a trouvés sur la plage en 2016. Donc, ça, c'est à peu près... Ça, c'est une des endroits, là, c'était pour montrer une des photos, mais on voit sur à peu près, sur ce site-là, sur seulement 100 mètres, on avait au moins une quinzaine de concentrations d'artefacts qui étaient sur la plage. Donc, que le site avait déjà été détruit. Donc, ça veut dire qu'il a été grugé puis que ça a été tendu sur la plage. Dont, entre autres, ça c'était assez important comme découverte qui se retrouvait sur la plage, malheureusement, donc plus dans son contexte. C'est un assemblement de bifaces qu'on pense qui était avant une ancienne cache de bifaces. Parce que les Autochtones, à l'époque, quand ils étaient nomades, ils revenaient souvent sur le même territoire. Ils vont souvent se faire des caches, soit de nourriture ou, comme dans ce cas-là, d'outils. Donc, en sachant qu'ils allaient revenir, donc c'est un peu par survie ou pour ne pas avoir à refaire un trajet, ils vont se cacher des objets. C'est des outils qui ne sont pas tout à fait terminés, sachant pas nécessairement qu'est-ce qu'il y aurait besoin. Donc, est-ce qu'il y aurait besoin d'un couteau, une pointe de flèche qui aurait été cassée? Donc, sachant pas qu'est-ce qu'ils allaient avoir besoin, ils n'ont pas fini les outils. Et c'était pour éventuellement les terminer avec selon les besoins. Donc, on a trouvé cette cache-là. Ça a été aussi une chance. On les a trouvés, mais tout leur contexte est quand même disparu. Donc, on se doute que c'était une cache, mais est-ce que c'était vraiment ça? On ne le sait pas parce que le reste du site autour a disparu. C'est le site CKE-27. Celui-là aussi, on voit très bien l'érosion. On voit vraiment toute la berge avec les arbres déracinés, le sable qui s'est vraiment effondré, même un arbre un peu couché. Ça démontre vraiment la progression de l'érosion qui est rapide en ayant des arbres déracinés comme ça. Puis là, on voit à côté de Montclou une concentration d'artefacts. Ça ressemblait à ça. Donc, c'est beaucoup des éclats, des outils sur place, des outils qui étaient nécessairement taillés de la carrière. Mais on voit comment ça s'étale. Et ici, le site CKE-43. Encore une fois, on voit la berge qui est vraiment en érosion. Sur la photo en bas, à côté de mon GPS, on voit vraiment les éclats qui dégringolent de la paroi. On voit pas très bien sur la photo, mais en fait, la couche de sol est vraiment rougie. Rougie veut souvent dire que ça l'a chauffé. Donc, on est sûrement proche d'un ancien foyer autochtone. Quand on est dans un foyer autochtone, on est souvent au centre de l'activité, au centre du site. Donc, c'est souvent là aussi qu'il y a la concentration d'objets de leur habitation. Donc, ça veut dire qu'on est juste à côté de perdre le centre du site. Donc, ça serait important d'investiguer rapidement. Donc, le projet qu'on a mis en commun, non, c'est sûr, on s'est dit le parc, c'était une de ses priorités déjà, mais la Première Nation a vraiment vu l'importance de mettre tous les efforts sur ces projets-là. Donc, à travers les autres projets qu'on a, c'est vraiment sur celui-là qu'on a décidé de mettre plus d'efforts ensemble. Comme, en plus, on n'était pas tout à fait sûr de ce qu'on allait faire, donc c'est pas quelque chose qu'on faisait souvent, de protéger des sites en érosion. Donc, on s'est dit, il faut vraiment qu'on recherche qu'est-ce qu'on doit faire avec les sites et comment les protéger. Comment recueillir aussi l'information qu'on pourrait avoir avant de tout perdre. La campagne 2017, donc l'année suivante, on a commencé à faire quelque chose. Premièrement, on s'est dit qu'il faudrait calculer la vitesse de cette érosion-là. C'est sûr qu'on voyait les artefacts sur la plage, mais est-ce que ça fait 20 ans qu'ils sont sur la plage et que finalement l'érosion est terminée? On se doutait que non, mais on voulait savoir à quelle vitesse quand même cette érosion-là allait. On a commencé par délimiter les zones des trois sites qu'on avait ciblés, donc vraiment délimiter la zone de sites archéologiques, donc pas toute l'érosion du parc, mais vraiment la partie du site qui était en érosion, pour savoir, on parlait de quel espace à protéger. Ensuite de ça, on a évalué aussi l'érosion. Est-ce que c'était une progression très active, modérée, lente, avec ce qu'on voyait? Y a-t-il de la végétation, pas de végétation autour? Donc, on a vraiment évalué l'état des sites. Et on a fait une inspection visuelle aussi. On a ramassé les artefacts. Le but de ramasser aussi les artefacts était de voir rapidement l'année d'après, est-ce qu'il y en a d'autres qui apparaissaient? Donc, on ramasse tout et là, après ça, on va voir à quelle vitesse ça va si on en voit encore beaucoup. C'est sûr qu'on sait qu'il y en a qui partent dans les flots, mais quand même, sur la plage, on voulait voir à quel point, comme j'ai dit, est-ce que ça faisait 20 ans qu'ils étaient là puis que finalement, l'année d'après, il n'y en aurait plus. On voulait voir la vitesse et on a installé des bornes donc pour calculer vraiment précisément est-ce qu'on parle de centimètres ou de mètres à chaque année qui disparaissent. Et l'année, à l'automne dernier, on est retourné. Là, c'est sûr que je n'ai pas encore de données là-dessus. Ça fait que 2 ans qu'on a installé les bornes. Donc, il y a quelques sites qu'on voit à l'œil que ça progresse, mais je n'ai pas encore de données de l'évolution parce que c'est sûr, en plus, on a eu des années un peu difficiles par rapport à l'eau. Ça fait qu'on sait que ça a érodé plus rapidement, mais est-ce que c'est quelque chose qui est constant pour les prochaines années? On va voir. On est en train d'inspecter. Donc, l'année passée, je suis retournée sur ces 3 sites-là, mais on a ajouté les 11 premiers sites aussi qui avaient été ciblés pour ne pas les oublier, les laisser de côté. On sait que ces 3-là, on les met en priorité. C'est sur eux qu'on a installé les bornes, mais on tenait quand même aller revoir les sites, continuer l'évaluation, continuer l'inspection visuelle aussi, voir s'il n'y avait pas des artefacts aussi importants qui auraient été encore accessibles et qu'on aurait pu récupérer. Donc, on a été voir les 11 autres sites. Là, on a essayé de penser à des solutions aussi de récupération, de protection des sites archéologiques. On s'est dit, ben là, comme vous dites peut-être, pourquoi pas en faire la fouille d'abord? Le problème, c'est que les espaces qui seraient plus en danger, comme tantôt je vous ai montré le foyer, peut-être que ce serait là qu'on aimerait viser. Mais quand on fouille, on creuse, on récupère les artefacts, on déracine les arbres autour, on remet du sol, mais le sol qui est remis est totalement... Il n'y a plus de stabilité du tout. Donc, en fait, c'est sûr que l'année suivante, il va tout à fait tout partir et peut-être créer plus d'érosion autour. Donc, ça l'accélère, en fait, le problème. Donc, c'est peut-être pas tout à fait la solution idéale. On s'est dit, OK, mais d'abord, on va fouiller tout le site en entier. Mais ça prend beaucoup de ressources pour faire ça. C'est peut-être pas la solution idéale non plus. C'est beaucoup de temps, beaucoup d'investigation. Donc, c'est pas non plus la solution idéale. Vous avez peut-être souvent entendu parler de l'enrochement, qui est une des possibilités. Mais il y a beaucoup de recherches qui se font actuellement, surtout sur le Bas-Saint-Laurent, la Gaspésie, les îles de la Madeleine. Puis on se rend compte, en fait, que l'enrochement n'est pas la solution idéale, a souvent tendance à accélérer le processus. À court terme, ça protège, mais à long terme, ça fait de l'érosion plus active. La roche reçoit la vague, il y a un effet de rebond qui va décupler la force de l'eau. Donc finalement, ça l'érode aussi tout autour, en dessous. Donc, finalement, les roches finissent par partir et le site aussi disparaît. Donc, c'est plus tout à fait la solution qui est choisie aujourd'hui. Il y a aussi la revégétalisation des lieux qui peut être une solution beaucoup plus douce, disons. Mais dans notre cas, on a un peu la problématique qu'on a dans le parc national où est-ce qu'on protège la nature telle qu'elle. On n'introduit pas des nouvelles plantes. Et le choix des plantes, il y a certaines plantes qui sont meilleures pour retenir le sol, mais dans notre cas, on ne peut pas choisir n'importe quelle plante. On est vraiment limité dans le choix. Et on ne veut pas non plus dénaturer l'environnement. Donc, ça peut être une solution sur certains sites. C'est vraiment, je pense que chaque site a ses possibilités différentes. C'est vraiment du cas par cas. Ça peut être une des possibilités. Mais si vous avez vu sur mes photos aussi, on remarque que la plupart de mes sites ont quand même de la végétation. Ce n'est pas nécessairement ça la problématique. Il y a certaines zones qui en ont moins. Donc oui, là, dans ce cas-là, on pourrait revégétaliser. Mais ce n'est pas tout à fait ça la problématique. La force de l'eau est assez présente. J'ai vu aussi d'autres possibilités qui ont été faites, des structures qui appellent en épi. Donc, au lieu de faire de l'enrochement, en parallèle à la berge, on va installer des poteaux, des arbres, mais qui vont vraiment, plus des structures qui vont aller s'avancer dans l'eau parallèle à la berge et qui vont permettre de stopper l'effet de la vague. Donc, ça peut être une des possibilités qui est moins dangereuse que l'enrochement, mais qui peut faire aussi son effet de stopper la vague. J'ai vu aussi des projets comme en Angleterre, je crois, c'est Sandwater qui étale en fait du sable. C'est vraiment un projet, puis ça a l'air à fonctionner. Donc, ils étalent du sable sur vraiment une longue partie de la berge. Donc, ils refont vraiment une plage très, très longue et qui permet d'arrêter loin la vague aussi. Le sable a beaucoup plus d'effet que la roche pour stopper, ralentir la force de l'eau et qui peut-être cette partie-là va être gurgée, mais beaucoup plus lentement qu'une berge qui est horizontale. Donc, c'est vraiment une des possibilités aussi. Encore une fois, dans notre cas, c'est toujours difficile parce qu'on ne peut pas trop introduire non plus dans notre parc. Mais ça pourrait être une solution. Donc, pour l'instant, quand même, on a des idées de solutions, mais ce qu'on veut faire, c'est plutôt calculer cette érosion-là puis l'évaluer avant de commencer à choisir les sites où travailler. On ne sait pas encore tout à fait quel site est le plus en danger et quel site mérite vraiment de mettre nos efforts puis de les étudier. Donc, c'est ce qu'on fait en premier. On a choisi en première phase parce qu'on s'est rendu compte qu'on ne connaissait pas vraiment bien notre problématique. Donc, on va calculer l'érosion avec les bornes qu'on a mis. Là, comme je vous ai dit, ça fait 2 ans. On va essayer de continuer ce calcul-là. Ensuite de ça, on va évaluer aussi avec des photos qu'on fait annuellement. Donc, ça va être vraiment où sur le site il y a le plus d'érosion parce que, oui, un site est érodé, mais il y a peut-être certaines zones qui le sont plus que d'autres. Donc, évaluer la différence, comme sur ces photos-là, une qui date de 2017, l'autre de 2018, puis déjà, on voit qu'il y a une partie qui est beaucoup plus érodée, il y a des arbres déjà tombés. Donc, on peut voir qu'on peut cibler certaines zones aussi du site qui mériteraient plus de mettre nos efforts. On peut aussi évaluer la vitesse d'érosion avec des photos aériennes. On a commencé à le faire. Donc, on a des photos du 1948, 1980. On en a de 1960 aussi. Fait qu'on peut vraiment voir où l'érosion se fait le plus vite. Et tout ça pour finalement cartographier nos sites archéologiques, les zones en érosion par rapport aux sites archéologiques, comme ici... je l'ai un peu imaginé avec ce que je sais, mais ça serait de faire ce genre de carte-là. Ou est-ce qu'il y aurait des zones vraiment qui sont le plus en danger pour la progression de l'érosion? Et ensuite de ça, pouvoir cibler où serait le travail à faire. Mais où serait le travail à faire? Moi, je pense aussi que ce n'est pas seulement où il y a de la progression d'érosion rapide, mais plutôt aussi cibler quel site est important. Important pour nous en tant que scientifiques, important pour la Première Nation, important pour le public aussi, parce qu'il y a certains sites en érosion, peut-être que ça va très vite, mais que finalement, c'est un site qui peut-être n'apportera pas tant d'informations, fait qu'on ne devrait pas nécessairement miser nos efforts sur ces sites-là. Peut-être aussi que certains sites qu'on se dit sont les plus vieux, bien, eux autres, on voudrait vraiment les protéger, ou peut-être que pour la Première Nation, comme c'est des sites récents, que ça fait vraiment partie de leur culture récente, bien, peut-être que c'est plutôt ceux-là qui vont vouloir qu'on mette de l'avant. Donc, je pense qu'avant aussi, ça va être de choisir quelles sont nos valeurs par rapport à ces sites-là et qu'est-ce qu'on tient à protéger. Parce que comme on dit, je ne pense pas qu'on va être capable de réussir à protéger tous ces sites-là. Donc, il va falloir cibler où on veut mettre les efforts et qui ne sera pas nécessairement où l'érosion est le plus rapide, mais plutôt aussi qu'est-ce qui est important pour nous, pour tout le monde. Et comme Mathieu l'a bien dit, je pense qu'une des réponses, c'est le partenariat, non seulement pour unir nos ressources, mais aussi se poser ces questions-là, qu'est-ce qui est important pour chacun, et d'aller chercher d'autres expertises, parce que je suis archéologue, je ne suis pas experte en berge normalement, je n'ai pas étudié en milieu naturel, je ne suis pas biologiste, donc c'est sûr que j'ai mes propres visions de la chose, mais ça peut être bien d'avoir aussi d'autres personnes dans l'équipe qui travaillent pour mieux cibler la problématique et quoi faire avec aussi. Donc déjà, la Première Nation fait partie du projet avec la CEPAC, le MCC bien sûr aussi, on pourrait
parler plus avec les municipalités de la région parce que le lac Témiscouata est très, très gros et le parc fait juste une petite partie. Donc, le reste des berges avec des sites archéologiques, c'est plus la municipalité qui s'en occupe. Donc, ce serait de s'unir ensemble. Surtout qu'eux autres, ils ont d'autres problématiques par rapport aux berges. Donc, on sait que souvent, ça a cette tendance à soit permettre de moins polluer l'eau aussi, d'avoir des berges bien protégées, donc une barrière. Donc, ça peut être aussi, ça peut faire partie des sites à protéger de cette façon-là. L'université aussi de l'UQAR, l'université à Rimouski, a un gros programme d'évaluation des sites en érosion de toute la côte nord et la Gaspésie, le Bas-Saint-Laurent, donc voir qu'est-ce qu'ils font eux. Je sais que eux autres aussi, c'est récent, mais de voir leurs résultats pour peut-être les appliquer dans notre parc. Je sais que c'est sûr que l'érosion est peut-être un peu plus grave le long du fleuve Saint-Laurent, mais quand même voir comment qu'ils ont réussi à trouver des solutions par rapport à ça pour être appliqué dans notre parc aussi. Donc, en conclusion, bien, je pense que c'est à continuer le projet de mettre nos efforts ensemble, de se réunir comme aujourd'hui pour voir chacun comment qu'on travaille avec cette problématique-là qui va assez vite pour unir nos efforts. Et parce que je pense que la solution, il n'y en a pas rien qu'une et n'est pas facile parce que c'est un problème vraiment complexe et chacun va trouver un peu sa solution, mais mieux vaut pouvoir avoir les possibilités ensemble. Et parce que les changements climatiques font en sorte que l'érosion est beaucoup plus rapide aujourd'hui, puis vraiment, vraiment beaucoup plus rapide. On le voit de toute façon, tout le monde, avec les inondations, les tempêtes beaucoup plus violentes, les glaces qui prennent pas l'hiver parce qu'il y a trop de redoux. Donc, ça aussi, les glaces protègent l'érosion, protègent les berges. Donc, ça veut dire que l'hiver, les sites sont pas plus protégés. Donc, il y a au moins la moitié du temps qu'ils étaient protégés qu'ils le sont pas. Donc, vraiment, il faut miser là-dessus. Et finalement, je remercie le Parc national qui me permet d'être ici aujourd'hui et la Première Nation, Malécite de Vigée, que je devrais dire Wolastoqué, qui collabore avec nous dans le projet. Je remercie aussi le CCN de m'avoir invité à présenter et la Première Nation algonquine d'ici de nous accueillir. Merci.
Merci beaucoup, Marianne Marie-Lou. Alors, our next speaker, I'd like to invite Nadine up to the podium.
Thank you. So, as I'm sure you're all aware, in 2017, the National Capital Region witnessed record-breaking flooding that was considered at the time to be an anomaly of high water amidst the regular spring floods. However, those levels were exceeded again this year in what may be the new normal. These events, alongside the long-term cumulative effects of seasonal fluctuations in water management practices, are believed to have been particularly damaging to archaeological sites along the shores of the Ottawa River. There are 24 known archaeological sites along the river in this region, which is a testament to its important role as a central transportation network and occupational corridor for millennia. These fluctuating water levels and erosion have impacted and endangered many of these sites. The issue of erosion along the Ottawa River has been known for a long time, and concern for the damage occurring to archaeological sites in the area had been raised long before the catastrophic floods of 2017. As long as 100 years ago, avocation archaeologist Thomas Walter Edwin Souter recorded finding artifacts recording out of the banks of the Ottawa River. Nearly 20 years ago, Marcella Liberté recommended that the problem of erosion of archaeological sites in Lac-Lamy Park needed to be urgently addressed. Erosion was identified at this point to be the greatest threat to these sites. Based on observations dating back to 1993, it was estimated that about 10 centimeters of shoreline was eroded annually. Inaction over the past couple of decades has had a devastating effect on the fragile archaeological resources along the Ottawa River. Moving forward, it's imperative that measures be taken to mitigate against further losses. And this begins with the Assessment and Rescue Archaeological Legacy Project, or ARL Project for short. The first phase of this project took place in the late summer of 2018 by Patterson Group. It involved a shoreline survey of National Capital Commission properties along the Quebec side of the Ottawa River to assess erosion damage to known archaeological sites and to document any previously unknown archaeological resources. The aim was to provide a baseline for informing recommendations for mitigation and management of these endangered sites. Fieldwork will continue this summer on the Ottawa side of the river. And phase two of the project will consist of the implementation and management of strategies for protecting these archaeological sites. Importantly, stewardship of the archaeological legacy of the National Capital Region should be managed with Indigenous groups in the area. As such, the aerial project was undertaken in partnership with Anishinaabe students from the community of Kitigan-Zibi and incorporated on-the-job training for the students. Collaboration with Kitigan-Zibi and Pikwakanagon First Nations is an integral part of this project. Future collaborations with these communities will allow for their active partnership in research and management of these archaeological sites and will assist these communities in acting as stewards of these valuable archaeological resources, which represent the legacy of their ancestral occupation of the area. So the project began at Lac-Lémy Park at the Lady Aberdeen Bridge and moved south towards Jacques Cartier Park and then the remainder of the NCC lands along the Quebec shoreline all the way to the Champlain Bridge. You can see our study area in blue along the Quebec side of the river, and there are approximately 18 sites, previously known archaeological sites in this area. It's about an 11-kilometer stretch. The sites are represented as red stars, which hopefully you can see in that map. Fieldwork consisted of pedestrian survey and controlled surface pickup, or put simply, we walked along the shoreline and we collected and recorded surface finds. You can see here the students that are collecting surface finds, and you can see the act of eroding shorelines. You can see roots and tree fall, and you can also see some of our pin flags that are in the water. So find spots were demarcated with these pin flags, and often a find spot is not a single artifact find spot, but a concentration of artifacts in about a 50-centimeter radius. Photographs were taken of all these find spots to document their current state and to make recommendations for protection in the future. These find spots were recorded using a handheld GPS device with an accuracy of about 1 to 2 meters, and it was interfaced with with ArcGIS collector on our iPads that we could use for real-time display of all these find spots. So you can see in the picture on the right is all of our find spots, a screenshot from one of the iPads, and you can see that there are multiple find spots, especially in Lac-Lémy Park there and Jacques Cartier Park. And then the other photo shows our GPS device and the iPad at one of the find spots. Since some of the sites, each find spot was assigned a number associated with the known site or for a newly designated site location. And since some of the previously known sites were close together and their extents were always not known, it was difficult at times to determine which site a find spot should be assigned to, but by accurately mapping them, the location of each find spot, we can then later understand the relationship between these different sites and the relationships between these artifacts, so it can be better understood in the future. A total of approximately 18,000 objects were collected and inventoried from this phase of the project alone, and these were only from 482 individual locations. On this map, the find spots are located, they're the blue spots, and the previously known spots are the red hashed areas. And as you can see from this map, this is a 2017 spring map, so it's from the flooding, it's a Google map. Some of the find spots are actually located in the water, so they are inundated at the high water mark already. Material recovered is almost entirely pre-contact Indigenous origin. There is a small sample of late 19th and early 20th century historic material, but it's largely lacking in context. And while there are some significant Euro-Canadian historic sites in the study area, none of these appear to be in danger of shoreline erosion. The vast majority of finds were located at previously recorded sites in Lac Lemie Park, which accounted for about 84% of our finds, and Jacques Cartier Park, which accounted for about 16% of our finds. So you can see here, Lac Lemie Park and Jacques Cartier Park and our find spots in green. And especially at Lac Lemie Park, you can see that the find spots are just overlapping each other. There are so many of them. A couple of potential of new sites were found at Lac Lemie Park. Six additional find spots were found at Jacques Cartier Park. And we had a single new find spot that was made in the vicinity of the Portage Bridge. This initial survey reaffirms the tremendous archaeological importance of both Lac Lemie and Jacques Cartier Parks and highlights the threat of ongoing shoreline erosion in these areas. The lack of find spots in other areas of the Quebec shoreline, as seen on this map, can be attributed to several factors, including disturbances due to urbanization and the effects of erosion that have likely already destroyed some archaeological sites. Erosion is most visible in the sandy and silty soils of the Gatineau River Delta, and especially in areas where they feel the full effects of the Ottawa River. Erosion in the Delta typically takes the form of bank erosion, where sections of the riverbank are eroded by wave action, which exposes the tree roots and removes vegetation. This creates a vicious cycle in which the soils are weakened and rendered unstable, loss of vegetation, and then tree fall occurs, and then the shore becomes more susceptible to further erosion. You can see in these photos the roots that are exposed from the wave action, the tree fall, and then you can also see some of the pin flags in the water from already eroded areas. We also have sheet flow erosion that's occurring in some areas, and this is where seasonal flooding causes the removal of sediment from large floodplain areas from high water levels. The material that we collected throughout this survey corresponds with what had previously been found in these locations. And lithics, or stone tools, and the material left over from making stone tools comprises the majority of our finds, about 98% of the recovered material, and a small amount of the recovered material was pottery. So of the lithic material, about 90% of it is Kitchissippi chert, which is found locally in outcrops near Lac Lemie. And we also have some transported nodules throughout the Gatineau Delta. Other cherts in the collection include Southern Ontario types such as Onondaga, Haldimand, Bois Blanc, and Kettle Point. And then we have some Northern Ontario types such as Gordon Lake and Hudson Bay Lowland. You can see in this image of some of the bifaces that were found that there are many of the different cherts here. Most of them, I think, in this picture are Kitchissippi and a few other types. Other exotic materials include some chalcedonies from an unknown source and also pure white quartzite from the Mistassini Lake in central Quebec. Some other materials are locally available, like quartz and quartzites. We have rhyolites, groundstone materials such as hornfels and gneiss. So here's a photo of some of the other tools, and also a variety of stones that were used to make these projectile points here. These lithic materials indicate a well-developed technological tradition with far-ranging trade networks. So as you've seen from the bifaces before and these projectile points, we have different types of flaked tools, and we also have some edge retouch tools such as scrapers and spokeshaves. The pottery from the all of our find spots appear to be mostly diagnostic of the Point Peninsula tradition of the Middle Woodland period, and this dates from approximately 2400 to 1000 years ago. This tradition featured more refined ceramics than found on earlier sites, with decoration occurring as various forms of stamping applied in a number of ways. And the most distinctive form of stamping is pseudo-scallop shell impressions that you can see in the photo on the left there. And it consisted of impressions in a zigzag pattern applied at various angles on the exterior of the vessel. Another form of stamp is the dentate, and that's a square impression that was made by a tool that was likely somewhat like a comb. These stamps were applied either as symbol stamps or rocked back and forth. And examples from this project include both, as you can see, and these are all rim shards. So from the rim of a vessel. Of the number of sites identified, the aerial project determined that 8 were experiencing active erosion, and indeed, the displacement of artifacts was visible at 2 of these sites, to the point that artifacts were washing away in front of us as we tried to collect them. Another one of the sites that was relocated was found that it would be eroding imminently, and that is the one circled in blue here. So these 9 sites are of the highest priority and require immediate action. Fortunately, several of the other sites appear to be stable, but should be included in a monitoring program. Notably, 2 known sites that were previously mapped in close proximity to the shoreline were not relocated during this survey. It's possible that these sites might actually be further inland, and if that's the case, we should do some more testing to try and confirm their location with subsurface testing, so shovel test pitting and that. But if we can't find them through this other testing, it is plausible that these sites have already washed away. It's clear from this brief survey that the important resources, archaeological resources of the Ottawa River are in danger. These sites encapsulate valuable evidence of the millennia of human occupation in the National Capital Region and must be protected or mitigated accordingly before they are lost. While some of the previously known sites are subject to archaeological research from the 1990s and 2000s, there's still much to be learned from them. Specific recommendations for protection and mitigation vary from site to site, and further sampling work should be undertaken to better understand their extents, their significance, and the threat level regarding future erosion. There are a number of potential solutions which could be applied to mitigate erosion going forward. Monitoring will be an important first step to better understand and quantify the erosion and determine priorities. One low-cost option for quantifying erosion might be employing UAVs or drones. With the installation of permanent benchmarks, a drone survey would allow for the accurate tracking rates of erosion and water levels. Options for mitigation can range from strategies for increasing shoreline stability, such as hay bales, infilling, sandbagging, and revegetation, all the way to undertaking salvage excavations. However, I must note that shoreline stabilization techniques are merely a temporary solution at this point. Ultimately, based on the current and expected future rates of erosion, rescue excavation is the only way in which significant information can be salvaged from these sites. The public excavations conducted by the NCC are a good example of such salvage work and provide the opportunity for public engagement with archaeology. This type of community-involved excavation has been used successfully as a strategy for mitigating shoreline erosion elsewhere. Public engagement is of the utmost importance. It fosters an understanding of the importance of heritage resources and the reasons for funding efforts to preserve, protect, and present them in a time of ongoing climate change. It is imperative that salvage efforts continue on a larger scale in the coming years, and that Anishinaabe groups are involved in the implementation of these kinds of programs to allow for capacity building within the communities and to provide direct stewardship of the archaeological record of their ancestors. As non-renewable resources, these sites represent an important archaeological legacy that are a testament to the occupation of the National Capital Region for the past 5,000 years. It is the duty of the government to be the stewards of the country's cultural heritage, and in particular those unrepresented in standard historical narratives. What is most clear from this initial phase of the Assessment and Rescue Archaeological Legacy Project is that urgent action is required now to prevent further loss of artifactual and contextual information from these valuable sites, which together form a nationally significant archaeological complex. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nadine, and thank you to all of our speakers. I'd now like to invite Christina Ruddy to come up, and you can either sit or you can come to the podium and give us some thoughts about what you heard tonight and some ideas that you'd like to share.
Sure. Thank you. I'm going to stand because I've been told I'm a different person when I stand, that when I sit and talk to people, it's... it's different, so it's better to stand. So, and probably all the cursing and inappropriate comments is what they're talking about, so I'll try and keep it clean. Shore erosion. When I was approached to talk to come and give a commentary tonight, I went, I should at least Google that, right? Because it seems like common sense, you know, climate change, floods. My community floods now in 2017 and this year, so Pickwackinacon is very affected by this. You know, so it seems like a very common sense thing, right? So, I did some research. I read some articles and went, oh, I don't think I'm ready to be an archaeologist yet. I'm no Ian. So, but the one story that really got me interested was one I read on CBC from 2014. And it said that archaeologists from a university in the States had found a hunting blind from in Lake Huron, on the bottom of Lake Huron, for looking at caribou hunting. And it reminded me that I sit on a board of directors in our local area for our outdoor education center, where they found caribou horns or antlers, in a river right by our community. And so with that, and the life-changing experience of working with Ian Badgley on the Kabeshinon Pavilion in 2017, and I say that was life-changing because when I did that project with Ian, I got to hold a piece of our history in my hand that was 9,000 years old. And I've always known I was a First Nations woman. I always knew I was Algonquin. I also know I'm Irish, and I can go on the internet and trace that history as back as far as it goes. I can't do that with Algonquin history. But I held something in my hand that was 9,000 years old that came from my ancestors. And it was probably the first thing that connected me to being an Algonquin woman. So, outside of doing the lots of fun stuff that I do with the museum, the cultural center, the First Nation, the projects I get to work on with Ian and other NCC staff, I have been part of a research project. So I think this is where my knowledge is probably going to be the most useful to this. It's about, our research project is about ethnomathematics. People usually glaze over when I say that. It's okay. I'm not going to go into it too much. So, but the concept of how we started that project and how I came on board to that project is essential to how this needs to progress and how this almost needs to change a little bit. And that's me being very top layer of what we're talking about. So, when we talk about research, we talk about math, and we talk about teaching kids how to learn math and doing all that kind of stuff and Anishinaabe ways of knowing. But the first thing we did was we sat with the community. Those researchers came into our community and they sat and they listened. For a whole day they listened to our community, and they have never stopped listening. This relationship has stretched over 7 years. This relationship is to the point now where when I go down their way where they live, I stay at their house. And that relationship is always giving back to our community. There was a time, and this is what I said to them when they came to my community to do this, because archaeology is research. When they said, we want to do this research, we want to learn about how First Nations people learn math pre-contact. And I'm like, I don't know what you're talking about. I can't do math. They make fun of me now about that. The first thing I said before I said that was, if you're going to come in and you're going to research my community and you're going to take that research and I'm never going to see you again, I have no interest in your project. So, I think that's the takeaway for me about this is that we need to do this work connected to our communities. When I first heard, the first time I heard Murray Sinclair talk, and of course, TRC, we know who Senator Murray Sinclair is, he said in BC, they sat for 4 days and listened to the women in the community in a circle tell the story of their First Nation. And they knew they were getting behind, and they knew it was going to put them behind, but they knew they also, it was more important that they sat there and listened to that story. So how can we incorporate those kind of relationships? Because for this to continue, for this to carry on and not just be stored inside a museum vault somewhere, you need to engage those First Nation communities. And as we always say in my bio and when I'm introduced, my work is always focused around how can I help our youth? How can I help them live, right? High suicide rates, we all know this stuff. This is stuff we don't normally talk about, probably in an urbanism lab. But it's what motivates me to learn math. It's what motivates me to come and say yes to Ian, whatever. Sure, Ian, I'll come do that. Can I bring some kids? And he's always, bring the kids. He's the first one to say it. So that I want every single First Nation and Inuit youth to experience what I experienced when I held that 9,000-year-old artifact. I want them to feel so connected to their ancestors that that's what gets them up every morning and gets them to school and drives them every day. Because that's a big part of what drives me every day. When I forget who I am and why I'm here, I remember that 9,000-year-old artifact and that came from my ancestors. How amazing is that, right? So for me, that's what I hear now when the more I think about shore erosion, that's what I think about, is that relationship and how that's going to be connected to Indigenous people, not just as a museum display or as written in a book. And for an example, and I know there's some people here from the museum, but I'm going to pick on you for a minute. I recently got an email from a cousin of mine that we found out that there's over 200 verbal stories about our language being held at the Museum of History. And in all the work that I've done with the Museum of History, I did not know this. And again, apologies, I love you guys. But, and I want to keep working with you, I'm overwhelmed. I found this out 2 months ago, and I haven't even had time to place a call to my friends at the museum and say, hey, how can we get this back into a community? My coworker is going to hear his grandmother's voice for the first time. We have no language speakers left in our community who can carry on the language to their children. We have second language learners. That information, how long has that been sitting at the Museum of History while I struggle around to try and revitalize our language? So that's what, when I seen those books, that bookshelf that you put up there, that was a real trigger for that work that I still have to do. So are those books with the First Nations that those books belong to, right? So build relationships with communities. It's more than doing a report to Chief and Council. It's more than writing a paper. It's about listening. And and contributing to their story. So I don't know if I went over or under, but I think I got you. You're good? Okay. Thank you.
Do you want to have a seat? So now we're at the point in the evening where it's up to you to come to the speakers, to the microphones, and ask questions. Donc, à vous la parole. On a deux microphones. Je vous encourage de demander vos questions dans la langue de votre choix, et nos présentateurs vont répondre dans la langue de leur choix. Alors, please, I welcome you to come to this to the microphones. Certainly, this has been a really interesting discussion, and it has led to some really interesting questions that you might have. So I welcome you to come to one of the two microphones and ask a question. Who wants to be first?
Good evening. I live on the shores of the Ottawa River, and I'm intrigued when I walk by the Ottawa River shoreline. It's on the Quebec side, close to where you have started, just downriver from Lemie Lake. And we have found shards, and I held them in my hand, and I didn't know whether they were 4,000 years old or older. And my question, though, is when I saw the revitalization of the NCC of that stretch of Jacques Cartier Street, of how the shoreline was, I would not call it enhanced, but changed with mats, with rocks. Is that a positive strategy of securing shoreline? Or is that so much change that anything else can be lost during, I mean, there was major excavation, major, so if you can put that into perspective for me of, is that, yeah, where would that be on the sliding scale of shoreline securing or shoreline changes to the point where things would be lost?
So you're talking about putting mats along the shoreline to protect it? Okay, so I'm not aware of where this was done. I haven't been on that shoreline since last summer when we did the survey, but I'm sure that is a way that they're trying to stabilize the shoreline right now, and in the hopes that nothing is lost until eventually something better or some other technique can be used to better preserve that area.
I think that if you're talking about the revitalization of Jacques Cartier Street, which is which the NCC was involved in as a partner with the Ville de Gatineau, any excavation or work that's done involving federal lands or federal activity needs to go through archaeological surveying before it can be done. I was not around to I can't answer the details of exactly what was done, but based on my knowledge of how we operate, that would have been a key element before any work was done, and that any important findings that were found would have been collected, protected, et cetera. I don't know whether Lucie or Ian have anything to add about how that would have gone through. And I don't know exactly where the ownership of the land falls under. Because depending on where the ownership of the land falls under, then there would be different rules. If it was federal land, then it has to follow federal guidelines for archaeological surveying and other things. If it's provincial land or municipal land, then there's other rules. Unfortunately, that's the mosaic that we live in with different rules and regulations that overlap each other. So that's what I would venture to answer for you now, but we can potentially get you some more information about that and be happy to get back to you on that. Catherine.
Hi. Congratulations and thank you to all the speakers and as well to the closing statements. I have three questions. The first one is, I think mostly goes to the three of you for the three speakers. What was there any factoring in of the human impact on archaeological sites? Because I know that you were looking in 1970. What do they look like in 2019, 2017? I'm not an archaeologist, but I'm a humanist, and people don't follow rules. I'm just curious if any of these sites had been demarcated, protected, and maybe if people had just taken them and walked away with some of the artifacts. Is that a factor in some of your research and the studies? The second piece, also being a humanist, is sometimes I feel like people like going to museums, but they don't see the full picture about, you know, how did things get to the museum and the kind of resources that have to go to back it up. I have no doubt that making a case for archaeological protection is a hard one sometimes when people are seeing things as, if you spend money here, you don't spend it on other things. But I think the big piece when you do archaeological site digs is some of the knowledge and teachings and discoveries that you might make. So I'm curious if the three of you could share one of the most amazing discoveries or things that you've learned from an archaeological dig? Some amazing thing, I don't know. And the third question was, I'm very curious what the coastal acronym stands for.
Okay, Matthew, I'll let you start.
Okay, I'll start. Your first question was about the human impact on these eroding sites. There's a couple of different ways that humans impact them. The first is through development. These coastal and riverine locations are places that, they were great places to live in the past. They're great places to put your houses now. And so there's been a lot of development on these sites, and some sites have been destroyed by development. But the provinces and territories, in 1994, you saw the previous rescue archaeology program at the museum. It ended in 1994. It's not because we gave up on it. It's because the provinces and territories took control of their heritage legislation, and they took control of their resources. And so the role in protecting the sites went to the provinces. And they developed a really good means to protect sites from development. And that's through the CRM archaeology. They downloaded the cost of that onto the developers and said, if you're going to impact a site, you have to hire an archaeologist to save the information. And so that sort of destruction doesn't happen much anymore. But collectors at eroding sites are an issue. I found there's not a lot of active collecting going on where I work, but collectors are a great source of information. They know the landscape intimately. A lot of the times they're collecting because they're just walking the shoreline and they realize that if they don't pick this up, it's going to be gone. And so what they're doing is they're filling the vacuum that's left by the lack of archaeology and the lack of study. And so one of the things we do in the coastal project that we work in on now is we meet with collectors and we have these things called show and learns, sort of like the Antiques Roadshow. Bring us the stuff you found, we'll tell you what it is, we'll tell you how old it is, and the only thing you have to do is tell us where you found it and what you know about it. And we found that saves us a lot of survey. We found sites this way. We found a 12,000-year-old site in the South Shore that nobody knew about before. And so collectors...
You let them keep them?
Well, that's up to the province. The province has specific legislation. And so we encourage them to donate. We encourage them to disclose. But we don't. We try not to judge. Because most of them aren't doing it professionally for money. They're doing it because there's a vacuum left by the lack of interaction with these sites. That's an amazing sort of thing that we do, and we found it very successful. What does COASTAL stand for? It's a big, long acronym. Community Observation, Assessment, and Salvage of Threatened Archaeological Legacy. It's a 24-gallon one, but it works, COASTAL. And the community part, you can tell it's the very first. And you know, I appreciate your comments so much. In my work and in modern archaeology, it all stems from the community. And you talked about those books. Do they go back to the people that they deserve? Though the books I write do. There's a book in that Mercury series is coming out in September, and the foreword's being written by the chief. And we're going to have a ceremony to give the book to the community. And all of the knowledge that we've gained has always been shared with the community there. And that leads me to your second question. What's the biggest thing I found on one of these sites? It was a clamshell with a little lump of clay in it. Doesn't sound like much. But what it turned out to be, we talked to the community. Do you guys know what this is? Not really. But why don't you check these sources? And so we checked these sources. And come to find out, in Mi'kmaq tradition, keeping the fire going, in Algonquin tradition, keeping the fire going for a long period of time is a very important thing. It was usually the task of a woman. And in this esoteric sort of source that the community told us to look at, it said, it was written that a woman that could keep a fire going was revered amongst all other women, and that she would use a clay-lined clamshell to preserve the spark to travel from the winter site to the summer site. And nobody had ever found this artifact before, and we found five of them in one midden. And so it instantly turned that shell midden from a domestic site where people were gathering and shucking clams to a spiritual site where women were coming together to do communal work and to revere each other for keeping the spark going from the winter to the summer site. That was the most important thing I found, and it was just a clamshell with a lump of clay in it. The community was so excited by this, they put this artifact on display. Artists have now drawn, done paintings of the woman with the clay-lined clamshell. So we talk about engaging with the community. That's how we do it now. I think that's all three questions.
Okay. Marianne?
Oui, je vais te répondre en français. C'est correct. Pour la première question, en fait, nous autres, on a la chance au moins d'être dans un parc qui est protégé. Donc, pour tout ce qui est infrastructure, avant, c'était des terres de la couronne. Donc, à part quelques chalets qui ont eu des petits sentiers, il n'y a pas, beaucoup d'infrastructures qui étaient faites avant. Donc, les sites sont quand même protégés. Par contre, c'est vrai que où est-ce qu'on a vu, où est-ce qu'il y avait des anciens chalets avec des plages, bien, effectivement, c'est là qu'il y a le plus d'érosion. Donc, on remarque vraiment que l'effet d'avoir dévégétalisé l'espace vraiment amplifié l'effet d'érosion. Pour ce qui est aussi des gens qui vont venir récupérer les artefacts, maintenant, l'espace, les gens, il faut qu'ils suivent les sentiers. Donc, l'espace est vraiment beaucoup plus protégé, mais on fait beaucoup d'éducation aussi auprès du public pour leur expliquer quoi faire s'ils trouvent les artefacts. Donc, c'est vraiment une façon. Mais c'est sûr qu'avant l'ouverture du parc, beaucoup, beaucoup de gens qui faisaient des collectionneurs qui passaient autour, mais un peu comme Matt a dit, on les considère pas comme des... On va les considérer plutôt comme des gens qui nous aident, qui ont fait en sorte qu'ils ont trouvé certains sites archéologiques, mais on les amène à comprendre aussi l'importance de savoir où ils les ont trouvés, puis de venir nous les rapporter. Fait que c'est un peu la même procédure qu'on établit avec eux autres pour les collectionneurs. La deuxième question qui était... Oui, c'est ça. En fait, c'est le site qu'on est en train de fouiller en ce moment qui a été une super belle découverte parce que des 54 sites archéologiques, la majorité, comme on est à côté de la carrière, sont des ateliers de taille de pierre, donc des endroits où est-ce qu'ils passaient, qu'ils s'arrêtaient pour venir fabriquer leurs outils. Donc, ils se ressemblent quand même beaucoup d'une époque à l'autre, sauf le site qu'on a trouvé cette année. Bien, cette année, qu'on fouille cette année, qu'on a trouvé il y a 2 ans. Qu'on ne trouve pas la matière première de la région, mais on a trouvé plusieurs matières premières de vraiment plein d'endroits ailleurs dans le même front de feu qui ont été jetés dans le feu. Donc déjà, d'avoir ce geste-là de jeter dans le feu, c'est pas la même chose comme sur les autres sites parce que les gens s'installaient, ils laissaient les outils un peu autour du front de feu, mais là, ils ont vraiment fait le geste de jeter. Donc il y a eu un espèce de don, de sacrifice de ces objets-là qui venaient en plus d'ailleurs et de vraiment très, très loin. Donc on a même des objets qui viennent complètement du nord, du Labrador, donc très, très, très loin. Donc, on se dit que ces objets-là avaient beaucoup plus de valeur. Donc, aussi, non seulement des trouver là, mais pourquoi ils les ont jetés. Donc, il y a peut-être vraiment on ne peut pas savoir exactement qu'est-ce qui s'est passé, mais un rituel de don ou de remerciement à la nature ou je ne sais pas. Et possiblement aussi un rassemblement de beaucoup de gens qui venaient d'ailleurs parce que c'est ça, on a vraiment des objets qui viennent du Nouveau-Brunswick, qui viennent du milieu du Québec, du lac Mistassini. Donc, il y a vraiment plusieurs... Ça a été notre belle découverte qu'on continue de fouiller encore cette année pour mieux le comprendre.
Aideen?
Okay, so with the NCC sites, there are definitely a lot of people that come along the shoreline and collect, especially Lac Leamy Park. There are known sites there, especially with the NCC excavations that happen. People know that the site is actively eroding. And Ian just asks that people come and bring the artifacts when the excavations are going on or come to his office, and he can help identify them and educate them about these artifacts. And we actively saw people looking for artifacts while we were out there surveying, to the point that we stopped at one point and our pin flags were still there because I could only record so fast with all of the other students. They were all identifying locations and I was recording them. We went and had our lunch and one of the collectors went ahead of us past where our survey had extended and just kept going and found like pottery and all sorts of things. And he showed us to them as he came back and as we came back for our lunch. But we just asked that he show Ian, and it would be nice maybe to get photos of them and that sort of thing to document that the artifacts are there and know exactly where they were from. Yeah, it happens. But like Matt said, it would be washed away otherwise in some cases. So it's a bit of it's being rescued, but we're losing the context.
Collectors aren't quite that aggressive in Nova Scotia.
Yeah. As for your second question, I think that's a question that, I mean, it changes all the time. Like, what is the most interesting thing you found? You always get that question from people when they find out you're an archaeologist. And I don't know, I always have a different answer. It depends on what I've recently been working on or that sort of thing. But I just find overall, it's just the finding like the one artifact. I primarily work on historic sites. So there's a lot more context and you can sometimes link artifacts or a site directly to a family or a person. And it's that link to the past that I find especially interesting. One of the first projects that I really gained an appreciation for Canadian history was I worked at Fort Henry in Kingston, and I was finding those artifacts and actually appreciating the War of 1812, and that like Canadian history can be interesting, whereas in high school like textbooks are pretty dry. So for me it was that, the connection to the human link of the past.
Great. Are there any other questions? I thought there were some other people in line, but if not, anybody else have any questions or comments that they want to share?
I'm going to ask the question in English, so I'm sure everybody will understand. Sorry. There have been archaeology elsewhere, other countries. There have been other experience as well. And I was wondering if there has been some lesson learned from other country or experiment that have been done somewhere else whereby we could, maybe it's something that we could try in Canada. Maybe we could try in certain circumstances. So I'm curious to know if there have been some other experience somewhere else in the world.
That's a really good question. And we recognize that, and just this past May, we invited some experts from other nations to come give a lecture at the Canadian Archaeological Association conference, and we had a sort of panel discussion around that. We invited Tom McGovern, expert in the United States, who's trying to develop a national program. They don't have one either. But we did. We also invited another Tom Dawson, from the Scottish Coastal Archaeology and the Problem of Erosion project called SCAPE. It's a very successful project. It's been going for 20 years, community-based, they're partially funded by the Heritage Lottery in the UK. And what's remarkable with that project is that everything they do is community-based, and I think that's why they've lasted for so long. They work with individual towns and hamlets and villages to preserve the heritage in those villages. They work project by project. So we learned a lot.
Christina went to speak to them and told them how to do it. Have to talk to the people first.
That's right. So. That's right. Yeah, exactly right. So they really done a fantastic job, and we learned a lot from looking at their model. In fact, some of the models we're using in Coastal, as far as triage and site assessments go, were developed and borrowed directly from SCAPE, and we've applied them to Nova Scotia. And I think Ian is applying some of those models as well to the NCC, and I think Ian was using those as well. So as far as countries that have national programs, there's not many. I mean, if Scotland has its own program, but we just learned that Denmark and Sweden have funded national programs. Denmark, the Carlsberg Foundation gave $4 million to develop a national erosion program, and in Sweden, Norway, the country just earmarked $3 million to develop a national erosion program. So this is happening in other countries. We don't know what their programs are going to look like yet. We're wondering where their models are being developed from. I talked to Tom Dawson. He hasn't heard from them yet. it's something we're monitoring. So there are models. In Canada, things are a little bit different. We have the original people that lived here, and it's their history that's being washed away. And so we're trying to build the DNA into such a program that permits them to control how these sites are monitored, how these sites are excavated, what sites are excavated. If we do have a funding program, the eligibility criteria, that would have to be built into community archaeology co-management would have to be built into the DNA of the proposals. So.
Avez-vous quelque chose à rajouter?
Je pense qu'il est bien dit. Okay. Je n'ai pas beaucoup.
OK. Oui. So I think this will be our last question. Alors, notre dernière question.
Voilà, la même lancée, en fait, pour continuer en français. Et la dimension que je voulais apporter, c'est la dimension internationale et la dimension de partenariat institutionnel et communautaire. Et je crois que la question a été soulevée. Et il y a la dimension développement, il y a l'aspect de développement, développement communautaire. Donc, il y a plusieurs institutions communautaristes ou communautaires qui essayent de mettre en place une certaine stratégie, une certaine approche des relations avec la nature, avec le territoire et des relations entre les résidents, entre les membres de la communauté. Donc, il y a l'approche communautariste qui est non seulement relationnelle, mais qui est aussi territorialisée. Mais il y a également l'approche nationale ou nationaliste ou institutionnelle à travers les politiques, l'État lui-même étant le pouvoir politique institutionnalisé. Mais par-delà de la nation, et là, il y a un problème de polysémie, nation ou peuple. Ici, on parlera de première nation. Et au niveau mondial, on parle des peuples autochtones ou indigènes. Ailleurs, on parle d'aborigènes. Donc, il y a une certaine polysémie au niveau de la notion de peuple. Mais on s'entend au niveau international qu'il y a les peuples indigènes. Mais au niveau national, donc, le problème de polysémie se pose. Donc, les premières nations, s'agit-il alors d'une communautarisation de l'approche avec le problème autochtone lorsqu'on parle de Première Nation? S'agit-il de communautarisation? S'agit-il de communautés autochtones, d'une part, donc dans leur rapport réciproque, ou bien s'agit-il d'une nouvelle approche de la citoyenneté considérant les rapports non seulement au niveau communautaire des liens restreints biologiques et autres, mais également des liens territoriaux, donc dans les rapports avec le territoire, l'érosion des berges et désertification, avancée de la mer. Donc, au niveau global, donc, le nouveau rapport étant la déterritorialisation, c'est-à-dire une déterritorialisation qui n'est pas seulement physique, qui se voit seulement au niveau donc, de l'avancée des mers, de la mer et de la désertification, mais qui se voit aussi au niveau virtuel des rapports communicationnels. Donc, est-ce que les rapports à intégrer, donc la modélisation, s'agira-t-il d'une modélisation communautariste ou d'une modélisation institutionnelle et supranationale visant une déterritorialisation, mais une déterritorialisation avec une participation importante et croissante des populations, des citoyens, dont les liens ne sont pas seulement au niveau communautaire, c'est-à-dire territorialisé, mais au niveau communautaire déterritorialisé, au niveau mondial du Canada, du Canada, village global. Merci.
Est-ce que vous voulez commencer?
Oui, je peux.
Did you follow? I don't know how the translation went.
Ben en fait, je pense que oui, je répondais à ta question en même temps de le dire, de la poser. Je pense que oui, ça va venir des deux. Dans le cas du parc, peut-être que c'est le cas aussi pour les autres. Ça va être, oui, c'est les Autochtones parce que c'est leur en territoire ancestral, mais je pense aussi à la communauté qui habite là actuellement. Donc, c'est sûr, c'est un lien un peu plus difficile à faire parce que c'est pas nécessairement leur passé, mais c'est là aussi qu'ils ont vécu. Donc, c'est un lien qui est à faire peut-être un peu plus en profondeur, mais toujours dans la notion de territoire de chez eux. Mais oui, je pense que ça doit aller aussi plus haut, donc d'une question plus nationale. Donc, je pense que ça doit venir de partout. Mais comme ce que tu disais, Matt, c'est que comme en Nouvelle-Écosse, je pense, que ça fonctionnait beaucoup les projets à cause qu'ils impliquaient les gens de la communauté. Puis je pense que ça, c'est une des clés.
You're absolutely right, and community projects are key. We know that SCAPE was successful because of this. It's the issue with erosion isn't isn't just an Indigenous issue. It's not just a Euro-Canadian site issue. It's a community issue. Those are communities of people whose histories are being washed away, but also communities whose front yards are being washed away and whose tourism prospects are being washed away, whose local heritage that they're quite proud of is being washed away. And so the approach, one of the reasons why the workshop suggested a funding program was necessary is because one solution doesn't fit all. One community doesn't have the same approach as another community, and so that's why a funding program would be necessary. But developing a community project, I think, is something that has to be built into the DNA of any sort of overarching national funding program. It would be impossible to come into a location with a top-down approach and just remove material. That's not sustainable. It's not useful. It's not the way modern archaeology works nowadays.
But if I understood part of what the question also was asking was that it starts off at the community and it is the community that's involved. But in essence, that heritage belongs to the nation and to the globe. And so how do we, so, you know, sort of building on what Christina was saying, is it's your ancestors and it's the people of that particular area, but it's also telling a history of humanity and humankind, and it belongs to the world also. So how do you distinguish that, or how do you also share that history and legacy, not only with yourselves, but share it globally, like so at a national level across Canada and also potentially globally, because I think he was also talking about desertification. So in Africa, obviously you have different cases of history being lost, not because of water, but because of lack of water and other things. So, but that's part of human history. As well.
Je pense juste rapidement, je pense que c'est vraiment la raison pour laquelle on présente ce soir aussi en public. C'est une des raisons d'impliquer aussi tout le monde puis qu'on soit au courant pour la raison que tu dis.
I think we have a lot of opportunities now with the internet and social media that a lot of these projects can be presented in that way. A lot of projects have blogs that you can sign in and read about the project. So I think that's one way that we can globally present the archaeology to people, the stories and the human past. And globally, we can definitely do it that way, nationally as well. But within the community, it's definitely, like you say, like talks like this so that people can come and learn about it.
As far as preserving information for the sort of global human history, this is something that, of course, that is important. It's not just Canadian history, Indigenous history; it's global history that's being affected. Preserving the data is the key part of that. Archaeologists now that are engaged in this sort of work, in some respects, have to change the way they operate. Instead of writing things up and interpreting things, in some cases, we just need to get boots on the ground and get it out with as much fidelity as possible, and leave it to the next generation to interpret. Leave all of that data for the next generation to interpret. Providing the data to communities, providing the information to communities is vastly important, but preserving it in a sustainable archive is extra important, and that's how we contribute to the history of the human world, of the record of humans on the planet. It'll come. We just have to preserve the data first.
Okay. On that note, I'm going to end. I'd like to thank all of our speakers once again. So please give them a hand. Thank you all again for coming out tonight. Merci beaucoup d'être venu ce soir. We look forward to seeing you again in September for our next season. Donc, on espère vous voir en septembre. On va commencer notre prochaine saison du Labo d'urbanisme. Alors, bonne saison estivale. Have a great summer, everybody. Merci et bonsoir.